Thank you all for being here. This is the 2016 Visit Glendale Annual Meeting and Recognition Event. My name is Eric Strunk, and I'm the Director of Public Facilities, Recreation, and Special Events for the City of Glendale. I've been honored, and I was asked by Lorraine to kind of kick off this morning's event at this very nice facility, the Thunderbird Event Center. Many of you may know this dates back to World War II. It's got a bit of history, and it was used primarily for flight training of soldiers that went overseas. So it does have a storied history in Glendale and in Arizona. Both Lorraine and I and the team in the city are thrilled to see so many of you here today. And we want you to help us soar to new heights in the travel and tourism industry in Glendale and the West Valley. I get the honor of introducing our MC for the morning, but before I do that, I just wanted to share a quick story. This individual represents a magazine of wonderful, beautiful photos and stories about the state of Arizona. And I didn't grow up in Arizona. I grew up in the state of Colorado. That's my home ground, although Arizona's my home now. But I remember as a kid growing up seeing Arizona Highways magazine in the libraries at school at friends' homes. And I remember thinking very clearly as a kid, someday I'm going to go visit the state of Arizona and see some of those sites. So now, fast forward all these years later, I annoy my wife, I annoy my kids, and we get out and about and we get to go on weekend trips to see a lot of what was in the magazine that I saw growing up as a kid. So let me tell you a little bit about our MC. As the publisher of Arizona Highways magazine, Wynn Holden leads the organization in its diverse activities centered on a world-renowned magazine. A Valley resident since 1980, Wynn was recognized by the Phoenix Business Journal as a 2015 Lifetime Achievement Award winner and was a 2007 inductee into the Arizona Tourism Hall of Fame. He is active in many charitable and community organizations. He was the co-chair of the board for Arizona in 2016. That's the group that hosted and staged the 2016 College Football National Championship game. He served as chairman of the Fiesta Bowl and the Greater Phoenix Chamber of Commerce Boards of Director and chaired the Phoenix Pride Commission. He also served as chairman of the Arizona Centennial Commission. We all remember that from a few years ago. And was president of the Centennial Foundation Board of Directors. As you can see, he's truly an advocate for the state of Arizona and its tourism industry. If you could, please extend a warm welcome to our guest speaker and MC, Wynn Holden.
Well, good morning. Oh, you can do better than that. Good morning. We're in Glendale. It's a beautiful Arizona day. What could be better than this, right? Pretty nice, huh? I was telling Lorraine this morning when I arrived that this building has a lot of very, very fond memories for me. In the early 80s, there was a program here called Interad, part of the graduate business program, and advertising students were making their final presentations in this room, and I served as a judge for, I guess, something like 9 years. And so this room has a lot of very, very fond memories. But what it also brought back in coming onto the campus was an education experience that I wanted to share with you that I recall. And that was that the first semester of my undergraduate year at Southern Illinois University, we had a public speaking class that was required. The idea was to hopefully give you some confidence and ability to speak. So the professor, the first day of class, handed out one sheet of paper, had the syllabus and other information, said, take this, go back to your dorms, you're done for the day. And we thought, wow, this is pretty cool. Get out 55 minutes early on our first class. This is awesome. So we read the sheet, and what it said was, go to the bookstore, ask for item 427, take it back to your room and read item number 2. Okay, went to the bookstore, 427. Clerk pulled out a big volume and a bag and handed it to us. We paid for it, went back to our dorm rooms, opened up the bag, read the instructions, and it was take the contents of the bag, which were marbles, I mean literally old, the playing marble, stuff them into your mouth, stand in front of a mirror, and begin to read from the book, which when I looked at the title was The Collected Works of William Shakespeare. I said, okay, not totally sure jammed all the stuff, stood in front of the mirror. And then we started to catch on. Because as you reached a certain level of elocutionary proficiency, you were able to take out a marble. And as you went on and read through the book and it progressed through the semester, you take out another marble and another marble. And at the end of the term, after you'd lost all your marbles, you were ready for a career in publishing. So now, Mayor, that could work politics. Joe Serretta, that can be candy, whatever you, Mickey, whatever. So fill in the blank on your own profession there. I'm really pleased to be able to be here with all of you this morning. And as I mentioned, the historic nature of this building, the marvelous group of folks that I've had the pleasure to serve as an MC for this event before. But more importantly, we've got several dignitaries that are joining us this morning, and we want to acknowledge them and the important role they play in helping to make Glendale the best city in the Valley of the Sun. So obviously our mayor is here. I mentioned him a moment ago, Jerry Wires. You're going to hear from Jerry in just a second. Councilmember Ray Malnar is also here. We really appreciate you being here. Glendale City Manager Kevin Phelps is also here, and again, you'll meet Kevin a little bit later this morning. And I also want to take a moment to introduce the Glendale team. These are the folks who run Visit Glendale, do events like this and so many others, and help promote this marvelous destination, not only to out-of-state residents, but also Valley residents as well. Because as you all know, there's a lot of tremendously exciting things happening in this community. And that obviously includes Lorraine Zomach, Jessica Alexander, Danielle Dutch, Kim Larson, and you already met Eric Strunk. Let's give him a round of applause. We also want to welcome the staff who are here this morning from our valued and dedicated partner organizations. It's my pleasure to introduce Glendale Mayor Jerry Wires at this point, who has a few words to share with us. And all of you know Jerry. He's one of those marvelous Valley institutions. He's been around for quite a while. He's done so many wonderful things, not only here in the city of Glendale as your mayor, but also for his many years of service in the Arizona legislature, where I had the opportunity to do some work with him as well. And you'll know, obviously you know, his commitment to tourism and travel as an important economic cornerstone, not only for Glendale, but also for the state of Arizona. He's a dad, a granddad, which I suspect is one of your most favorite occupations, and is just an all-around remarkably good guy. Would you welcome this morning your mayor, Jerry Wires.
Well, good morning, everyone. I was sitting here thinking as Wynn was talking when him and I first met, and it was when I was in the legislature, and it was just prior to Arizona Centennial. And I had told my assistant, I said, you know, I'd like to be on that committee. And she told me that the committee was full and they weren't taking any more. And I said, well, tell them that I nominated myself. I accepted my nomination and I voted myself in. And she said, well, I don't think they're going to take it. I said, just call them and tell them that. And she called over there and they said, sure, we'll take him, absolutely. But where I actually got to know Wynn is because of what Arizona has to offer, specifically the Valley, and people knowing that I'm a very avid, enthusiastic motorcyclist, ride a Harley-Davidson, I suggested that being that the state of Arizona was broke, we had virtually no money to celebrate our centennial, I had come up with this idea of an Arizona Centennial Copper Chopper, a motorcycle built that looked like it was made of copper because we wanted to celebrate one of the five C's that Arizona has, you know, with copper. And so we did a lot of work and got a lot of people put together. It took a long time. It was 17 months, I believe, that we sold tickets on this thing, similar to a lottery ticket. And each month somebody would get drawn and they would get a key. And so when we had our centennial, of those 17 people, they'd come down and everybody would see if their key would start to motorcycle. And at any rate, the ride itself, the actual ride, we went started off at the shopping center over at Bass Pro Shop in Mesa. And we knew it was going to be fairly large. And when I got there, I was astounded by the amount of motorcycles. Now, I've ridden to Sturgis, I've been in Florida, I've been at a lot of motorcycle events across the nation. Ours wasn't as big as a lot of those, but for Arizona, it was ridiculously huge. And I was in the very front with a Centennial Copper Chopper, and we rode in, stopped at the Capitol, got off the bikes. I went and used the restroom, came back, got a soda, and was drinking a soda. And I asked the highway patrolman, I said, when did the last motorcycle get here? And he looked at me, and literally his mouth kind of dropped open. And he said, sir, they're still in the parking lot in Mesa. They're still leaving. Over 10,000 motorcycles, if you can imagine, 10,000 motorcycles celebrating Arizona, celebrating the riding weather that we have. And we bought the motorcycle and had it actually built locally. No, we didn't go to Orange County Choppers, or we had it actually done here, and he's an award-winning builder. That actually raised a lot of money for our Centennial because we didn't have funds. We didn't have a way to really go to the state and say we need money because the state was going through a major turndown at the time. But that was when I first got to know Wynn, and we probably held, I think, probably one of the most successful events the state's seen in a long time. It was kind of a neat way to celebrate Arizona's birthday. But with that, I'll go on to what I'm supposed to be telling you. I'd like to officially welcome all of you to the 2016 Glendale Annual Meeting and Recognition Breakfast. The purpose of this event is to thank all of you for helping make Glendale and the West Valley not only a national destination choice, but also an international destination that continues to attract tourists from around the world. And I'm going to go off script again. Anybody watch the football game last night? Yeah, awesome game, right? Especially because we won. Did you notice how many times they kept referring to beautiful Glendale, Arizona? You know what? That's awesome. That we can't get that kind of publicity when we're getting in it for free like that. It's awesome. You know, visitors come to the Valley for a wide variety of reasons, and they specifically come to the West Valley to enjoy one-of-a-kind amenities, attractions, and mega events that we have to offer. For 2 days, April 1st and April 3rd, we'll be hosting the NCAA Men's Final Four tournament at the University of Phoenix Stadium here in Glendale. This is the latest of a series of mega events that continues to place Glendale in the West Valley on a worldwide stage. From Super Bowls to Fiesta Bowls and to the College National Football Championship, visitors also come for spring training at Glendale's Camelback Ranch and many of our other spring training facilities in the West Valley. They visit Westgate for amazing special events, shopping, as well as professional hockey and headlining concerts at the Gila River Arena. Coyotes won their home opening game. Sweet. Yeah. And let's not forget our incredible park system. Thunderbird Conservation Park, for example, features more than 1,200 acres of beautiful Sonoran Desert, where visitors enjoy hiking, biking, and horseback riding. Glendale is honored to serve as a tourist getaway to the West Valley and to the state of Arizona. I'd like to also applaud the efforts of the Glendale Convention and Visitors Bureau and all of our partners here today bringing a regional voice to our efforts to promote tourism throughout the West Valley. Now, it's not just Glendale, it's the West Valley. We all work in partnership. Through our regional and statewide partnerships, we're able to brand the West Valley and the state of Arizona as a premier travel destination, one that offers memorable experiences and endless options to visitors. I want to thank all of you for supporting the Glendale Convention Visitors Bureau and for your continued partnership. I wish you much success in the year ahead. Thank you so much for allowing me to come out this morning. Good day.
That copper chopper really was something, and when we drew the winning, I'm sure you will remember this, Mayor, we drew the winner from this group of, 17, something like that. It was a, and I don't mean to be pejorative here, this is an apt description. It was a little old lady who had no clue what even to do with a motorcycle, but I'm sure she sold it for a very tidy profit, and it was a beautiful, beautiful piece. We're now very pleased to welcome Kevin Phelps to the podium. Mr. Phelps was appointed Glendale City Manager in February of 2016 and brings more than 30 years of private sector experience and 18 years of government sector experience to the city's top management job. For the past 6 years, Mr. Phelps has been the highest ranking appointed official in Pierce County, Washington, an area that includes Greater Tacoma and is the state's second largest county. Mr. Phelps was previously a deputy auditor in the Washington State Auditor's Office and served for 7 years as an elected council member for the city of Tacoma. Prior to his tenure in government, he spent decades in the private sector as founder and managing partner of the Landmark Convention Center in Tacoma. Please welcome Glendale City Manager, Kevin Phelps.
Something like that. First of all, thank you. I'm so glad I'm here today. I get to hear a speech that uses the word elocutionary in the speech, and I don't even know how to define that, but I'm sure that if after you hear my talk, you'll know I'm not it, whatever that means. But anyway, thank you so much for being here. I wanted to come down and personally welcome each of you here. As was mentioned in my bio, I have some connection to the important work, the type of work that each of you do. For 16 years, I had the privilege of purchasing and redeveloping an historic property into a 100,000 square foot convention center in Tacoma. And I got a chance to see firsthand what the important role that all of us in this room play to really revitalizing and energizing a community. But also during that period of time, I had the distinct privilege of being able to chair what is certainly one of our country's large mega events. As was mentioned, what really attracted me to this job when I first looked at it, besides wanting to be here in the Valley, was the fact that, you know, you had the Super Bowl, you had the college championship game for football, and then this coming year we have the NC2A Final Four. Most communities, if you had one of those in a 10-year period, you'd be excited. And to be in a region where we have those back to back to back is really speaks a lot to what is so attractive about this area. Now, I do have to say, being from the Seattle area, I don't have super fond memories of the Super Bowl from a couple years ago, for those who remember the last, it was good up in the last few seconds of the game. But I had the ability, or the, was given the advantage of being the chair for the 2015 U.S. Open Golf Championship at Chambers Bay. And again, another major event that that really brought worldwide attention to our region. And so I wanted to be here today just to, again, to say that from the city of Glendale, we want to continue to partner with each and every one of you here in this room. We understand at City Hall how important what you do. Now, we're getting ready to embark on a strategic plan, which we've not had really for a number of years here in the city of Glendale. And part of that plan will be to continue to focus on those core elements that make this city great. And we believe that the conventions, the tourism, and visitors, each of those three segments, will play a vital role as we continue to move forward in the West Side. And so we're gonna, but we also wanna start measuring what we do. We don't want to stand pat where we're at. We want to push the envelope. We want to continue to invest our time, our energy, our resources in putting together strategies that will continue to grow this market. So again, I won't be able to stay, unfortunately, this morning to some of the recognitions that are there. First of all, I'm sure each of you deserve some level of recognition for what you do. For the winners that will be recognized this morning, congratulations. But I hope you'll continue to look at the City of Glendale, our team, and the council as being a really strong partner in what you do. And again, congratulations today. Thank you again for your invite. You guys, the city has been overwhelmingly welcoming to my wife and I. You know, we did survive August. It was funny, my wife and I ended up using WTA all the time because every time I would brag about how much we were enjoying our time here, the local residents would say, well, wait till August. And so WTA for us was wait till August. Well, we got to September and we didn't melt away, and we thought it was pretty good. And so I'm kind of convinced that the locals down here, you're the one who complains about the hot weather. I thought it was fantastic. So anyway, but again, thank you for your welcome. Enjoy the morning and take care.
Thank you, Kevin. I'm confident that this coming Sunday night you'll be wearing red, right? Attaboy. Welcome. We're glad to have you here. I want to take a moment now to introduce the people that really make a meeting like this possible, and that's our sponsors. I'm going to go through the list, read their names, ask them to stand, and when we're through at the end, we'll give them a rousing round of applause. So would you please stand when I call your name? Our platinum sponsor is the Glendale Ambassadors. Our gold sponsors, Key 360 Media, publisher of Arizona Key Magazine, and Madden Media. Madden publishes the Glendale and West Valley Annual Travel Guide. Be sure and stop by their booth to learn how you can take advantage of the upcoming travel guide issue. Space, I'm told, is still available, right, Lise? Okay, good. Our silver sponsors, the Arizona Broadway Theater, Super Shuttle ExecuCar, University of Phoenix Stadium, Wildlife World Zoo Aquarium and Safari Park, and our exhibitors, including Kiss Me, I'm Irish Run, and the Sonoran Airplane Company. Thank you all very much. We also want to extend special appreciation to Soretta Candy Company for providing the chocolate treats at each of your tables. And thank you to John Penich, our event photographer, and to Glendale 11 for covering today's events, which you will be able to read about and hear about and see on Glendale 11, as well as online, coming pretty quickly. So thank you all as well. Now let's meet our hosts for today. Please welcome to the stage Paula Tobin, Director of Sales for the Thunderbird Executive Inn and Conference Center. Paula?
How are you today? Better?
Oh, perfect.
I'm just going to have to adjust this a little. Good morning, everyone. So, by show of hands, how many of you knew about the Thunderbird School of Global Management? Oh, good. How many of you knew about the Thunderbird Executive Inn? Ooh. How many of you knew there was a hotel here? Oh, how many of you knew there were meeting space here? That is amazing. I can tell you, I just recently moved here. I've been here for about a year, and I too just survived my first summer, so I got my badge of honor. But I go out, I am a master connector. I love getting out and meeting people and talking with people and getting to know them. And if I go out and meet 10 people, 9 of them know about the school, no one knows about the hotel. I spoke with many of you today and you said, I didn't even know there was a hotel room here that you had an inn. So for those of you who do know about us, there is our little Glendale's hidden gem on each of your tables. You have now become ambassadors for us to go out and spread the word about us. You have been officially appointed our Glendale Hidden Gem ambassadors to talk about Thunderbird Executive Inn and Conference Center. So just to give you some statistics of what we have here, we have 134 guest rooms, and outside they look like an inn, but once you open the door, they are contemporary, modern, gorgeous. The bathrooms have been renovated with tile and granite, and they're beautiful. So for those of you who'd like a little tour later, a walking tour, I'd be happy to show each of you. We also have 40,000 square feet of meeting space. So ranging from this beautiful Thunderbird Event Center, also known as the Tech, this is 14,000 square feet of space. We have auditoriums, which are tiered auditoriums, that are wonderful. They range in size from 25 people to 50 people to 60 people, up to 230 people. So perfect for events. We do host social events. We've had 2 weddings here. So if you're interested in having a wedding, we can do that as well. We host retirement parties. We host holiday parties. We host everything. So when you're thinking about an event, think about us and think about our wonderful guest room. I want to say thank you. We have two guests here from the Thunderbird School of Global Management. We have Chelsea and Crystal from the Thunderbird School, our wonderful partners here. And I have my wonderful team here. I'm just gonna name them off really quickly. We've got Patty Davidson, the general manager, Danielle Ariano, our sales manager, Jason Raper, our convention service supervisor, John Fallon, recently appointed to supervisor at the front desk, Sandy Adrin, our director of housekeeping, Blanca Salazar, and the woman who made all of your places look amazing today, Shayna Van Atta. She is our recently promoted convention service manager. She handles everything in this area. So Danielle and I will book your events for you, and Shayna will make sure everything is perfect to the T, Thunderbird. So, if anyone would like a walking tour, we do have golf carts, but I would love to provide a walking tour. If anyone would like to see our convention or conference space that's not here readily available, we'd be happy to provide conference tours. But I want to say welcome and thank you so much for being here today. It's an honor to work with the team at Visit Glendale. I come from the East Coast, and I've worked with a lot of convention and visitor bureaus in my life. And I will tell you that they are one of the most supportive, creative, amazing teams I've worked with. They are dedicated, committing, and really committed to promoting Glendale. So thank you to that amazing team, Lorraine, Danielle, Terry, everyone over there, Jess. So thank you so much for that. But welcome, enjoy your breakfast, and I will turn it back over to our MC. I'll adjust it for you.
Thank you, Paul, and obviously your entire team for making this event so special this morning. We appreciate it. Now let's meet our platinum sponsor for today's meeting, Nancy Lennox, president of the Glendale Ambassadors. Nancy?
Okay. See that coming.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Nancy Lennox, president of the Glendale Civic Pride Ambassadors, now known as just the Glendale Ambassadors. We are proud to be the platinum sponsor today of this event. And what a beautiful location. This is just fantastic. The Glendale Ambassadors have been around for 22 years. Our members are citizens of Glendale and some of the surrounding communities who want to promote good things about Glendale as well as the whole West Valley. Our organization gives people the chance to get involved in community programs and events and to share their experiences with each other and their friends and neighbors. We network regularly at monthly meetings, community meet and greets, as well as fundraising events. You've probably seen us at a lot of the, if you go to the special events in downtown Glendale, we're the ones in the beverage booth. We sell everything from hot chocolate and sodas to a variety of wine and beers. No matter what, though, we're always having fun, no matter what. We have some great news to share for you today, and this location couldn't be the better place to tell you about it. We are now, the ambassadors are actually bringing back Sister Cities International program to Glendale. If you're not familiar with Sister Cities, it was introduced in the 1950s by President Dwight Eisenhower as a program that would bring friendship and hopefully promote world peace around the world. Since then, it has grown tremendously. Just even here in Arizona, almost every major city has a number of sister cities, and I think every state and major city in the United States and all over the world, again, have got a sister city. So it was definitely time for Glendale to get back in that arena. We did have a sister cities program back in the 1980s and 90s, and our cities were Delicious, Mexico, and Memmingen, Germany. But that program was dissolved, and so we're just so happy to be able to bring it back. We think Glendale needs to be back there in the arena of the sister cities. Our first sister city is going to be Orland, Norway, and we're very excited about that. Our connection to Orland is the fact that they have pilots training out at Luke on the F-35s. So it was just a perfect connection for us. Orland is going to be rolling out their F-35s next September, and so they will continue to train here in the United States and especially at Luke. We've been communicating regularly with Orland, and we hope to have our program in full speed, you know, up to speed here in just the next couple of weeks. So stay tuned, because we'll definitely be putting out a lot of press announcements about our sister city and giving you a lot of information to learn about them. To kick off our program, we're going to be doing a fundraiser that I wanted to just, you know, at least mention. There is some information on your tables. It's going to be on Friday, November 11th. It's sort of a girls' night out kind of an event and a fashion show that's going to be right here in Glendale and Catlin Court. It's $20 to attend, and we would love to have you join us. If you would like to get involved also, just in our organization in general, we would love to have you. We're always looking for new members. We do a variety of things here in the community, and we would love to have you. In fact, we have a few of our members in the audience today. Could you stand up? Any members of the Civic Pride? There we go. All right, thank you. We'll be in our booth for a few minutes after the event if you have any questions about our organization or especially about our Sister Cities program. And thank you so much for having us here today, and we're just proud to be a sponsor of the event today. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Also, as a special prize, I'm sure Lorraine will back me on this. If you can identify the flag of Norway flying in this room, as your new, we got some Norwegians out there. Okay, see Lorraine, she's got an extra diamond for you or something, I don't know. So thanks very much, Nancy. It's very exciting that the Sister Cities program is coming back in. We truly appreciate everything the ambassadors do on behalf of Glendale. Now I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our first guest speaker and my good pal, Debbie Johnson. Debbie has spent the last two decades working in the tourism industry in Arizona, and obviously she started before high school. She was appointed by Governor Doug Ducey as director of the Arizona Office of Tourism in August of 2015. Prior to that, she served as president and CEO of the Arizona Lodging and Tourism Association and the Valley Hotel and Resort Association. Debbie plays a key role in helping to shape Arizona's tourism industry and serving as the voice of its 200,000 plus employees. Please welcome AOT Director Debbie Johnson.
It is such a pleasure to be here. I have now been on the job officially just a little over 1 year, and I can't tell you what a whirlwind year it's been. I look out in the crowd and I see all the supporters and the people who really represent tourism day in and day out, and it makes me so proud. And I got to tell you, to start my day listening to Eric talk about traveling the state every weekend, I'm like, yeah, that's a great way to talk about tourism and really start your day. So thank you. I hope you all take his example and do that. I have got a quick PowerPoint because we've got some amazing visuals. So one of the things that I hear on my job is that, you know, we never see advertisements for Arizona. And Mayor Wise will attest to this when he's at the legislature. It's hard because we don't really advertise within Arizona. We do a lot of advertising elsewhere. And we're going to show you some pictures today, talk about kind of where we promote Arizona. And then afterwards, I know we're really tight on time, but I'm going to stick around for a few minutes afterwards if you have any questions. So, you know, these are great numbers, and I love always being able to talk about tourism growing. And that's a good thing for every single one of us in this room. But to be able to talk that we're up 42 million visitors, overnight visitors, $21 billion in direct spending. Tourism is the only industry that impacts all 15 counties positively, and that's something that we really want to talk about our story. I love these numbers up here, but the only one that I love to focus on, and again, poor Mayor Wires, but almost $3 billion in tax revenue that we give back to our cities, our county, and our state. Those are some pretty big numbers, and we should all be proud of that because that's what we live and that's what we do, and it helps fund, you know, a lot of our programs that we do within our own communities. We talk a little bit about where our visitors come from, and this is something that my goal to increase over the next couple of years is our international visitation. Obviously, domestic visitation is strong. We know that. We're going to continue to focus on that. But the international visitors who come to Arizona, they stay longer, they spend more, and they see more of the state. And, you know, that's a good thing for all of us. Just a quick thing about the partners that we work with. We work with all our partners, and again, Mary Wire said it best. We are best when we work together, and that's what we want to do, is we want to make sure that we're connecting everybody. Glendale is a fantastic partner. We appreciate all that you do. We really want to make sure that we're representing the state well, so you all can fight for the business once we get it here. Just, I'm going to show you some quick pictures. This is our national campaign, and it was a first of its kind campaign last year where we used social media influencers. We had five of them. I got to tell you, you know, you hear the word social media influencer, and when I first started at AOT, I was like, I don't really know what that means. Well, now I can tell you I know what it means, and they have a lot of power, and I didn't realize especially how much influence they have all over Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and Snapchat, which is growing. These are just some of the pictures that we've talked about. We had over 4 million media impressions, 50 million program impressions. The program won state and regional Addy Awards. We use some great research to talk about our programs, and that's what I think people need to know, is that we don't just pick these cities and kind of the campaign. We really want to know where our most important target markets are, and we do a great deal of research to find out where those markets are. So last year, our focus was Seattle, Chicago, Minneapolis, and then two kind of secondary cities of Portland and Austin. These are just some of the campaign, and we really targeted, you'll notice in these pictures, each city has a little bit different target that you'll notice. So this was Seattle. We did, you know, obviously print, digital, out of home, a whole bunch of marketing in Seattle. And you'll notice that we talked about 325 days of sun, because of course in Seattle, what do you want? Sunshine. We took over the ferry boat. If you've ever been to Seattle, there's a ferry boat that goes, there's actually two ferries that go over to Bainbridge Island. We took over both ferry boats, both of the terminals in Bainbridge and in Seattle. And I mean, there wasn't a spot that was open that wasn't taken by an Arizona picture. And then we went and we did some activations on, especially some of the holiday weekends where we were there. We rode the ferries with them, and I had the privilege of going. And people were asking us all kinds of questions about Arizona. They loved Arizona. Of course, their baseball team plays here, so that didn't hurt us at all either. And it really great messaging and some unique way to reach some of our audience. Chicago, we really, you know, focused on what you can do in Arizona and showing the messages and the activity that we can do in Arizona. And I think, again, Chicago's a big market. Chicago is one of our top markets for us, and we targeted our message. We also participated for the first time in the Chicago Travel and Adventure Show, and it was really fantastic. 25,000 attendees, all focused on travel. They were coming to this show just to learn about travel. Arizona had the front booth. We won best of show, and we talked to so many people about Arizona. And we've heard from people who have come to Arizona because of that show. We had some smaller activations in Minneapolis, Portland, and Austin. But what we showed, the research from this Target Cities campaign, $21.50. This came back in tax revenue for each dollar that we invested. We also have an international campaign, and we work with an organization called Brand USA. And Brand USA, 10 years ago, this organization didn't exist. The United States was the only major country that didn't have a tourism marketing organization for their country. Well, we do now, and they do a lot of great international marketing, and we couldn't afford to market internationally without Brand USA. So there's a lot of things that we're now able to do. We focus a lot on Canada and Mexico, of course, because they're our top two international markets. But we also have a presence in the UK, France, Germany, and China. Also, China's the largest growing international market, so we took that country on last year, and we're very excited about that. Of course, the other thing we do is spring training. We all know that March is the best month in Arizona. It's beautiful, it's amazing, and people come here. And what we love about Cactus League is that people don't just come for the games. They come for a week, they come to stay, and they see other parts of Arizona, they experience other things in Arizona, and we love that. That's the best kind of visitor. Our spring training campaign last year, we had 46,000 visits to the microsite, which was a 31% increase over our previous year. We have a rural marketing co-op program. Listen, we know the rural communities are a tremendous asset to Arizona. We know that people love to visit them, and so we want to help them in getting that message out about what you can do in rural Arizona. This year, we have 33 communities receiving over $1 million total from AOT to support what they do. Social media, everybody knows it's out there. I can't even believe how big social media is. This year alone, we have 55,000 Instagram followers, and we just started our Instagram account less than a year ago. So really amazing to talk about that. Twitter, 40,000. Facebook, over 400,000. The other thing we do and we're working on right now is our official state visitor guide, and with the help of Madden Media and our team, we really need to tell the story about AOT. And people, it's interesting because people go, you still publish a guide? We publish and print and then give away 450,000 copies of this guide. Plus we have it available to download. So I'm always getting that people always ask us, why do you still print the guide? Because there's still a huge demand. And the one thing we're learning about millennials is millennials now want that printed guide in their hand. They don't want just the internet. They want to have something with them. So we're going to continue to print it as long as people continue to want it. Media relations, and this is a great part of what we do, and one of the things that I've come to understand more and more is our media and trade departments. And I'm going to give you a quick example, and I think there's a picture up here down at the bottom. I had the chance in May to take 8 international journalists, one from each different country, down to the bottom of the Grand Canyon at Havasupai. And many of them, one was from the United States, and only one other person had ever been in the United States. None of them to Arizona except the one gentleman. And we took them down, we hiked Havasupai. And what I learned on that trip, and what I really knew, but you really see firsthand, is we can go out and we can tell people, I can go to these other countries and we can go to other destinations and we can tell them about Arizona. But to have these travel writers and tour operators and travel agents see Arizona and experience Arizona firsthand, there's nothing like it. Because let me tell you, all these people have gone back and done stories about Arizona and their hike at the Grand Canyon. And it's extraordinary coverage. And it's one thing for me or any of you to get out and talk about it. But when you have that third party talking about how amazing this destination is, it's something we do a lot and we love. We hosted 124 journalists, hosted them in state last year, 1,760 articles, 30 million in ad equivalency. We also had some tour operators here last year, 65 tour operators, and we trained 340 in China and Mexico. And again, you can see the numbers, part of our partnership with Brand USA there. You guys are going to get a sneak peek preview of our 2017 campaign. So we are going back to Arizona Expedition Season 2. That was our campaign last year. We've picked 4 new social media influencers this year. They're really amazing. We also added a new target city, which I think is so important, and that's San Francisco. And San Francisco, as you all know, is a big market. Little bit more expensive, and we really felt like it was that important for us to be there. So the other thing we have is we have 4 pillars, and we're really going to focus. So when I first started at AOT, you know, we're trying to be everything to everybody, but we really found out we need to, with limited dollars and limited resources, we needed to focus. So our 4 pillars are culinary, arts and culture, wellness, and then family and adventure. And so we're really kind of trying to focus on those pillars in every aspect, our marketing, our trade, our communications, PR. Everything's going to be focused on that, and hopefully, you know, we'll see some good changes from that. One of the things I get asked all the time is, how can you all work with us? Here's how. Keep us informed. Give us your calendar listings. For those of you out there, you know, that have events, our calendar of events page is visited more than all of our other pages combined. That's how big that calendar of events is, and we want to list everything. So if you have events, please let us know. We'd love to hear about them. We'd love to put them on our calendar. You know, join us on these sales missions. Glendale does a great job. They join us when they can on sales missions and trade shows, and we appreciate that. But you all are invited as well, so please let us know. The other thing we need is we need images. If you guys have images that you're willing to share that we can use for journalists, for travel magazines, we'd love that as well, because it's something that we get asked a lot, what they can do. We have Tourism Tuesday. If you're not signed up, you can do so on our website. It's a weekly communication that comes out and talks about all the things going on tourism in Arizona. We have an AOT Impact website, which is really a lot of our research and our numbers and things like that. And then tourism.az.gov is our business website. And it really gives any research that we have that we can share is on that website. And we have some amazing information on that website. If you ever have a question, go to the website first, because it can probably answer most of them. We really try to put everything that we can on there for you all, so you can do your jobs better as well. And if you have any questions, there's my information, and please come see me afterwards. And thank you again so much for the opportunity to be here. It's been an honor.
Thank you, Debbie. Appreciate you sharing that information with us, and congratulations on now the not so new gig anymore, but we're delighted to be working with you. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, the countdown is on for the 2017 NCAA Final Four, and I bet our next guest speaker can tell you not only the number of days, but the number of hours, and I'd bet probably the number of seconds to the big day. Dawn Rogers brings a wealth of experience in intercollegiate athletics to her position as executive director and CEO of the 2017 Phoenix Final Four. Before she was hired by the Phoenix Local Organizing Committee, Dawn was the ASU Senior Associate Athletics Director for 9 years and the Senior Women's Administrator at ASU as well. Obviously, this lady knows a thing or two about athletics and about business. Ladies and gentlemen, Dawn Rogers.
Thank you, Wynn. And as the co-chair for the college championship game, Wynn certainly knows a little bit about putting an event together. So I appreciate that introduction. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here with you today. We so appreciate Glendale and the West Valley and your partnership with us. We truly could not host this event, and certainly not the third event in 3 years, without an extremely cohesive region from a number of different standpoints: how we represent ourselves when we do the site visits, how we execute the events, and how we raise money to fund these events really takes a region that works together. And so we're so appreciative of everything that you all do here. I thought what I'd do today is kind of give you a halftime report, halftime basketball, and kind of talk about where we are. We started this effort last September full time. And when there's 164 days, I don't know the hours or seconds yet, but I'm sure I'll get to that point. But we have made great progress in where we are. And I thought what I'd do today in talking about this international event, which will bring 75,000 people to the game Saturday and Monday, each game, is really talk to you about where we are in our core goals and where we're making, how we're making our progress. So one of our core goals was flawless execution of the games. And we talk about this often. We've been fortunate to host Super Bowl on several occasions, to have several national championship games here for football. We've never hosted the Final Four. This is the first time that we'll be in Arizona. Because of the beautiful University of Phoenix Stadium, we're able to host this event. And it hasn't been West since 1995. So we really have one opportunity for this first impression when our visitors arrive and how they're greeted and what they enjoy. And so having flawless execution of the game is so important. And we're so fortunate to have this world-class facility here in the West Valley that's run by one of our board members. Tom Sadler is the president and CEO of ASTA. And of course, Andy and his terrific staff are here. We have such complete confidence in University of Phoenix Stadium and how they'll execute the game. They're very involved in the meetings. We have the NCAA comes in town once a month. They've been here 5 times. They're only here another 4, which kind of blows my mind how fast it's going. But one of the things that they've been so impressed with, and what we keep hearing about how we're ahead of schedule and that the process has never been smoother or easier, is again because of that cohesive region that we have. Police, fire, safety, security is such a big piece, and they've been so involved in our planning when we have those monthly meetings. And that's really where we've heard some of the highest praise, is our systems, our people, our team, and how well everyone works together. I really truly believe that we're ahead of schedule right now. One of our second goals was to the opportunity to highlight our entire state. I mean, we pitched this event because we had multiple epicenters. We had the ability to host this as a region. But we really have a unique opportunity to highlight the entire state of Arizona using our social media platforms that Debbie just spoke of. And we just hired an intern that's doing such a great job. If you didn't know, yesterday was National Dictionary Day. And of course, we liked the word basketball was our favorite word. But he's very active on our social media platform that is national, the @ Final Four. If you don't follow us, please do. We have a Facebook page too, Phoenix Final Four. We're really excited about the second year of an Enter to Win, and we're partnering with the Arizona Office of Tourism, and Debbie Johnson is our co-chair and certainly leading this great effort. They are ready to embark on a little trip around the state. They are taking the trophy and taking it around and showcasing a lot of things, but certainly the basketball tournament to the entire state. The NCAA, for the first time, is doing a newsletter that is being pushed out to all of our ticket holders and talking about all the things that they can do when they arrive here in Arizona, because we really feel like these visitors leave as ambassadors of our area. They leave and they talk about our region and they talk about how welcoming it was and what a tremendous opportunity it was to be here, and they come back again and again. We're also excited to use the platform of the Final Four to leave a lasting legacy on our community. And I think that a lot of us are so excited for the different projects that we're able to do around the game. First being our sustainability efforts, we're very excited to have the goal of zero waste around the stadium, around all of our ancillary events, looking at ways to have water offsets and energy offsets to change the footprint of this event. A lot of education, and then a sustainability playbook would be one of the legacies that we pass on to the next city on all of the efforts that we have so they can pass from city to city, city to city. We're going to do youth clinics. Those will be really fun. We'll do one out here in the West Valley. We'll do some days of service. We distributed 6,000 backpacks to Title I schools across Maricopa County, and we had several elementary schools out in the West Valley that we distributed to. And one of our really exciting projects is Read to the Final Four Arizona. And this, every year the NCAA has a literacy project. It's so important. It's the education is the core value for the association. And certainly for our third graders, it's something that is very important to each and every one of us and impacts the entire state. And so this year we're able to do a bracket where we invite every third grader across the entire state of Arizona to participate in the contest. We're doing it through an online platform called Myon, and they have the opportunity to opt in, and it logs their reading minutes. January 4th, the contest will begin. We're in the warm-up phase right now. January 4th, the contest will begin. And then on January 25th, the top 68 schools across the state will populate into a bracket, leading to the top four schools coming to Final Four Friday and the winner being recognized. We had a really fun event over at Desert Garden Elementary School. Coach Marley came out and read to the students, and it was really fun to see how excited we brought the trophy, and we gave them a cup when they left. And it's really neat to see an event like this and how it can affect different people's lives. And taking a young third grader that maybe doesn't love to read, or does love to read and has an incentive to read a little bit more, we think this legacy will leave a lasting impact on our state, and we're really excited about it. We have 19,000 students enrolled right now, and we hope to have well over 50,000 by the time that we get done and launch in January. We want to maximize the economic impact of this event, and we all know what these events do for our region and for the state. But the unique part of this event is that it's a two-day event with the semifinals on Saturday and the championship game Monday night with a four-night minimum. As I mentioned, we'll seat about 75,000 for each game out at the stadium. But what we're spending a lot of time on right now is our tagline, come early, stay late. So come early and experience spring training, or stay late and experience the rest of the state. On Sunday, the day off, for those of us that aren't recovering from being overserved on Saturday night, we hope that you'll get out and explore the state and everything that it has to offer. The last meeting that we had, we probably had 10 people from the NCAA staff stay and go and explore Arizona. So we think that this event really lends itself for people that come to Arizona for the first time around this spring break time to come early and stay late. And we're pushing that through our social media platforms. All of our cities have microsites to talk about what they can, what people can experience and enjoy in your city. So if they're staying in one part of the valley, they can go experience another part of the valley. And we think that that's very important. And last, we really want to have great partner satisfaction and engagement. We're so appreciative to everyone that it takes to run this event from a financial standpoint. We have a little under $1 million left to raise for the event, and that's really because of the donors that give to us, the cities, Arizona Office of Tourism, our partners, institutions that have been involved. We could not do this without their efforts. And so we wanted them to enjoy every part of this event. We'll start with a tip-off basketball party that we're doing for them. We have a golf outing. We have different behind-the-scenes events for them to really be able to see and experience this event for the first time. Because at the end of the day, we want cities, we want our donors, we want our citizens to want to have this event back. And so in order to do that, we need to do a great job executing for them to enjoy it. So this event will impact the West Valley in a number of different ways, but it certainly will start with Final Four Friday, which is an open practice for all of the teams to come out. It's a really fun way. The teams usually just kind of have fun and do different, you know, contests and shooting, and it's a great chance for fans as well as residents of the Valley to be able to see the teams. For a lot of people, this will be the first time they've ever gone to the stadium, so Friday kind of becomes that dry run when people come out and get to go visit. We'll have the games on Saturday. We'll tip at about 3:30 and 6 o'clock. We'll have tip-off tailgate going. Obviously, Westgate will be alive and well, and we'll really push fans to come out early. I even saw some of the things that Tanger did for the last two events, and those certainly will be things for fans to do over at that property as well. And then we'll be back out to Glendale on Monday night for a tip at about 6:20 to crown the national champion. Again, we'll push people out early so that they can avoid traffic and come out and really enjoy a fun Arizona afternoon and crown the national champion. So I'll close with saying that, and Mayor Wires referenced this, you know, we're known for the five C's in Arizona, but one of our members that was visiting pointed out so eloquently that we really should add a sixth C, and that's championships, because that's something that this state hosts so very well. So thank you for your support. I'll be around afterwards as well if you have any questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Dawn. A lot to look forward to in the next 6-7 months. Exciting time for the state of Arizona continues. So it's my great pleasure now to introduce Mike Vaught. Mike was appointed Grand Canyon University's Vice President of Athletics in 2014. Prior to joining Grand Canyon, Mike held several administrative roles within collegiate and high school athletics. Before coming to Grand Canyon, he spent 2 years in the private sector as Director of Corporate Sponsorships at Advocare International. At each stop along the way, Vaught has instituted a benchmark of striving for excellence while also becoming active in local and national charitable causes. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mike Vaught.
Good morning. It's an honor and a privilege to be here with you guys this morning. Thanks for having us. You know, when we talk about winning national championships, being successful in business or whatever it may be, it's all about people. And I'm very fortunate to have a great team, and one of my members is here today. I'd like to introduce her to our Associate AD for External Relations, Renee Gonzalez. Please stand up. If there's anything we can do with your organization or your company, see Renee, because we're all in on helping the community in any way we can. I was in Denver Airport last Thursday, delayed. Have anybody got to experience that before? Sat there for about 3 hours. This older gentleman came up to me and sat down, and we started talking, and I found out he was a retired Army general. And when I told him I had coached at the Naval Academy 6 years, we connected at that moment. I asked him to tell me his story, and he went on to tell me about his time serving our country. But he kept mentioning, because he's a sports fan, he kept mentioning for all the countries he served in while he was active, there was no sports, there was no youth programs, no athletics. And it was a really good reminder for me how fortunate we are to live in a country like we live in and under the flag that stands behind me and have the opportunity to do what we do each day. As I sat there after he caught his plane, his was on time, I had another 2 hours, I just watched the people go through the airport. Now, I'm guessing it was on a Thursday, I'm guessing 70% of those people were wearing their school colors. I saw a guy wearing a Purdue Boilermaker shirt. I think they won 3 games in 3 years in football, but he was proud of his school. All the San Diego flights that day, that was the night San Diego State or San Diego played Denver in San Diego, all those flights were full of families, kids, parents wearing their orange, going to watch the Broncos play. So I thought it was a good reminder how important athletics and sports is to this country and to our society today. I think we really need that. It provides a lot of life lessons for our youth, that in our adults even, that we can't get anywhere else. When you take your family to a stadium or an arena, even when I walk in, I'm excited because I know for 3 hours it's going to be fun, it's going to be family oriented, it's going to be exciting, and whatever you have going on in your life, you can forget about for 3 hours and recalibrate and walk out of there a different person. Don, I know, is going to do a fantastic job hosting this Final Four. I remember we unveiled that clock out there. I got off the plane the other day, it said 170 days. It seemed like yesterday we did that. So we'll be here before we know it. But I have noticed since I've lived here almost 2 years now, what a fantastic host city Glendale is for events. I mean, I just caught the Super Bowl when I first came here, then the National Championship football game, and now the Final Four. I know it's going to be a fantastic event, and it takes a lot of people to make that happen. You guys need to be commended on that. So give yourself a round of applause. A little bit about GCU. I've been here 2 years next Wednesday. We were brought in to help transition the athletic department to Division I status, and it all stems back. We have a fantastic president in Brian Mueller. His leadership team, they've been there now 6 years. It's an amazing story that'll never be told, I don't think anywhere in the country. When they arrived at GCU, for you guys that don't know, there were 600 students. It was not in good situation financially, just not good. They threw homeless people out of the dorm the first day. Fast forward now, we have 17,000 students on campus this fall, 61,000 online. There's been $700 million in facilities built. The crime rate's down 32%. Housing rates are up 30%. They're making a difference with the vision that President Mueller and his team had 5 years ago. It's absolutely amazing. It's changed since we've been here this morning. It happens fast. Renee and I went to a meeting in Denver last year, and we left on Thursday and came back on Monday, and the building that we walked out of our office to go to the car was gone when we got back. I mean, gone. It was a slab left. That was it. Hauled away. But a little bit about the athletic department. We've been charged to make that transition to Division I athletics. So what that entails, it's a four-year process. We have about 8 months left. We can play a Division I schedule. We're in a Division I conference. We cannot go to postseason play for 4 years. That's the waiting period. That's why we weren't in the tournament last year. Dan Marley did a great job with our basketball program. We were 27-7. We can't go to postseason play. We would have probably had four teams in postseason play last year. So we're anxiously awaiting next season. But to build toward that, we've kind of got a strategy to get national branding for our university, get our brand out nationally within the collegiate ranks. We were 27-7 last year, as I mentioned, and we may lose six games the first month this year, but there's a plan. We're not nuts. We open up at Duke. They happen to be ranked number one in the nation. Then we go to Penn State on Tuesday night after that. And then we have San Diego State, Louisville here. We go to Arizona. So we're playing some championship caliber programs in men's basketball this year to give our players experience of playing in that environment, to help our recruiting, and to give our school national branding. So we're actually going to have a better team than we had last year. We only had one starter graduate. We've got some great incoming players coming in. Coach Marley and his staff, you guys know Dan. He's a fantastic human being. And he's a great coach, and he's great for our university. So I urge you to come out and join us. We see about 8,000, and we fill the arena every game. But our student-athletes appreciate any support from baseball to softball. We're building new facilities right now. We're actually have a campaign going, 10-2 campaign. We're building 10 athletic facilities in 2 years. We have six done now, and the rest will be finished shortly. So there's a lot of construction going on at the university, along with more dorms, more classroom space. We just opened a new engineering building, so there's a lot of exciting things going on at GCU. Join us anytime. If we can do anything for you, please reach out to us. See Renee if we can partner with you in any of your areas. And thank you so much for having us here today.
I bet you couldn't tell Mike's from South Boston. Good to have you here. Thanks for sharing your morning. Now I want to take just a moment to recognize the Glendale team. We're fortunate to have a wide array of resources and expertise from the City of Glendale departments. This includes public information, creative services, parks and recreation, special events, administrative support, and so many more. We have several of our city team members here with us who work diligently to promote and enhance the Bureau's efforts. Please stand and be recognized, team, so we can thank you appropriately. Come on, get them up, get them up. Thank you. Now, if you call or stop by the Visit Glendale office, you've met their amazing volunteer team. These folks donate thousands of hours, and that's not an overstatement, each and every year to the Visitor Center. Please join me in thanking Nancy, Becky, Sue, Neva, Lorraine, and Pat for all they do. Thank you. Now I'd like you to meet the Visit Glendale Advisory Committee members who are with us today. The committee's made up of folks who represent tourism all across the West Valley. Committee members, please stand as we introduce you. Hold your applause until we get them all on their feet. The members are Mickey Olson, founder and director of Wildlife World Zoo, Aquarium and Safari Park; Steve Gerhart, owner of Arizona Scenic Tours; Matt Borowski, manager of the Spicery in our 1895 home; Valerie Berner, owner of Bears and More; Joe Serretta, vice president of the Serretta Candy Company; Nick Thiel, director of sales of Hilton Garden Inn Avondale; Bud Zomach, director of volunteer services, pastoral care in the gift shop at Banner Australia Hospital. Where have we heard that name before? I don't know. And Alan Tuttle, director of sales for the Renaissance Glendale Hotel and Spa. Thank you so much, advisory committee. Now, it's a pleasure to be able to introduce a couple of folks that you know pretty well, but it's time for one of the highlights of our program, the 2016 Tourism Awards. So please welcome Lorraine Zomach. Where did I hear that name before? And Eric Strunk to do the honors.
Good morning. What a beautiful group of people. I just love looking out and seeing all the smiling faces. This is truly one of the highlights of our year, as we have a chance to recognize the outstanding achievements of tourism and travel throughout Glendale and the West Valley. Our first award, Eric.
Thank you, Lorraine. This first award should probably come as no surprise. It's our Tourism Champion Award, which is given to an individual, group, or business that drives tourism to Glendale and the West Valley through product development, infrastructure, growth, and marketing and promotional strategies. Drum roll, please. Our tourism champion for this year, the West Valley Tourism Champion winner, I believe there's a PowerPoint up here. It's, of course, the University of Phoenix Stadium. So come on up and accept the award. A couple quick notes. Everyone knows the stadium opened in 2006 and obviously has a retractable roof and field. It's unlike any other stadium in North America. The primary tenants include the Arizona Cardinals. It's hosted Super Bowls, the Fiesta Bowl. All of us here today know that the 60,000 plus seats are regularly filled due to these events and all the neat things that occur there. But the one thing that I think the stadium has in common with most of us in this room is the hard work of the dedicated staff each and every day who have made the stadium a world-class destination, which has forever changed the face of tourism in Arizona. Congratulations to our tourism champions, the University of Phoenix Stadium.
Congratulations, University of Phoenix Stadium. You know, one of the things that truly sets the West Valley apart is how much we give back to the community through giving. Our next award speaks specifically to this vision. The Community Partnership Award is given to an individual, group, or business that makes a difference in our community by giving back through partnerships and outreach to local and global charitable causes. It is with great pleasure that we present our 2016 Community Partnership Award to the Seroptimus International of the Kachinas. Let me tell you a little about this wonderful group. A part of the West Valley community since 1980, the Seroptimus International of the Kachinas is a volunteer service group of business professionals that work to improve the lives of girls and women through programs leading to social and economic empowerment. Almost 85,000 Seroptimists in 132 countries contribute time and financial support to community-based and international projects that benefit women and girls. A program that is near and dear to the members is the Operation Women Warriors Project. Now in its sixth year, the members box and send over 200 care packages every spring to women, female military personnel stationed overseas. We are truly thrilled and honored to present the Community Partnership Award to the Seroptimus International of the Kachinas.
Our final award is the Spirit of the West Valley, which is awarded to an individual, group, or business that embodies the incomparable spirit and culture of Glendale and the West Valley. This year, the 2016 award is the Glendale's Farmer Market. So come on down. This is a throughout the presentations, we've talked about different destination features in the state of Arizona. This is one that's going to continue to grow in popularity and significance in Glendale and the West Valley. It sprouted in downtown Glendale last April with the goal of bringing fresh local produce and handmade goods to the area. It was the vision and dedication of Kathy Vanderwerp and her team to create a community gathering place in historic downtown Glendale. It also supports local farmers, small businesses, and community-based organizations. The purpose of the market is to provide a place for healthy, nutritious, and sustainable food systems for residents throughout the valley, Glendale in particular. Now beginning its second season, the market is quickly becoming a must-see for local visitors to downtown Glendale. Congratulations to our 2016 Spirit Award winner, the Glendale Farmers Market.
I wish we could do this every day of the year. This is so much fun. Well, many congratulations to our award winners and many, many thanks for all that you do. Well, shall we give away some more prizes? This time you might all have a chance to win something. So I'm going to ask Kim and Jessica to help us. We have some amazing prizes to give away today. And Eric, I'm going to ask you to draw cards here in a moment. Well, your trip to Glendale in the West Valley would not be complete without a sweet treat from our favorite candy maker, Soretta Candy Company. We have a wonderful chocolate basket to give away. Let's draw a card. All right. Oh, Fred Corsi, University of Phoenix Stadium. Fred, you do not have to share chocolate. Fantastic, he's happy, he's very happy. Well, it's become tradition for us to have the most amazing gift basket from the University of Phoenix Stadium. Our Miss Shonda, she hooks us up every single year. We have a beautiful gift basket. And let's draw another winner. Fred, you can't win this one. Miss Amy Epperson, fantastic. Well, our ambassador of fun, Cricket from Dave & Buster's, has put together a super fun basket for a lucky winner. And let's draw. Eric, you're doing a great job drawing. Okay, we've got a very lucky table over here. Mr. Scott Norton, you're heading out to Dave & Buster's. Big winners. Well, our final prize for today, someone is truly in for a flight of a lifetime. We are super excited to welcome our newest member to the CVB, Sonoran Aeroplane, the Municipal Airport. And Sonoran is providing an amazing flight in their 1930s style design aircraft. Yes, it almost feels like you should be on the wings. Don't do that. But someone gets to sit in the seat, and it's going to be an amazing ride. So thank you for the donation. And the winner is, please take me with you. I want my hair blowing in the breeze. Nancy Lennox, Glendale Ambassadors. Oh my gosh. Many, many thanks to our partners for donating those wonderful prizes. And we're going to wrap things up with Wynn Holden.
Well, congratulations. A little inside baseball thing, Mike, just more for you than anybody else. We have a timing script that Lorraine puts together, and you obviously have heard from a number of folks, very important messaging this morning. We were supposed to wrap by 10. We're going to beat that. I think it's a great testament to Lorraine and her production capabilities with her team. So well done, Lorraine. So after this 30-minute talk, we will... No, I'm just kidding. It's been a wonderful morning for tourism in Glendale and the West Valley. And behalf of Visit Glendale, the entire team at Visit Glendale, we want to thank everyone here this morning for attending. Special thanks to Debbie Johnson, Don Rogers, Mike Vaught, our marvelous sponsors, and our host, Thunderbird Inn and Executive Conference Center. We appreciate you very, very much. Many congratulations to all the award winners. And I wanted to leave you with a quick thought. One of my very favorite quotes with Helen Keller was at a press conference. This was obviously many, many years ago. And she was asked by a somewhat insensitive reporter, is the worst thing that can happen to you losing your eyesight? And she thought for a minute and said, no, the worst thing that can happen to you is to lose your vision. Clearly, Glendale has a vision, is executing against it, and you're all going to be the beneficiaries of it, as well as every visitor, every resident of the state of Arizona. Congratulations, Glendale. Make it a terrific day.